says, we lift our hands. And then part of us says, we're just here to praise you. And that's truly why we ought to be here tonight, isn't it? Just to praise him. Here we are. In your presence, lifting holy hands to you. Here we are, praising Jesus for the brought us through.
Amen.
I don't have the words to tell you how I feel. I don't know what I can say. I'm not worthy to speak your holy name. Yet you tell me you love me just the same. Here we are.
Here we are.
I never thought it could be this way, and I never thought I'd be the one you found me dying in my sin. And you looked at me with love and took me in. Here we are.
I'm blessed the Lord for it. We ought to praise Jesus. We ought not, that ought not be a strange phenomenon for us around here. I don't know if that's the right word or not, but it's close. You know, it's close. Sister, you got a song for us? Come ahead on. Amen. What a blessing. Good, good, wonderful.
Come to church, and I was just playing it while I was at home, but thinking about being in church.
Wednesday night a few weeks ago, I began to speak about the shadows, a few shadows. And so I wanted to take and speak tonight on the shadow. And we'll read this psalm, and then I'd like to speak from this psalm. Psalm 36, I'll read just one verse, and if you have your Bible, you may like to turn over to Matthew chapter number 23, and I'll read a verse over there. And then I'd ask you just to stay, follow with me in the Bible, if you will, to several, what I think are very choice verses. Psalm chapter number 36, verse number 7. Verse number 7. Now keep your finger in this psalm. We're going to come back to this psalm, but this is going to be the thrust of my thoughts right here. It says in verse number 7, "How excellent is thy loving kindness, O God. Therefore, the children of men put their trust under the shadow of thy wings." You see the reference there to shadow, the shadow of thy wings. And we'll be back to this psalm in just a moment. Over in the book of Matthew, chapter 23, in verse number 37, Jesus says, "O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, thou that killest the prophets and stonest them that are sent unto thee, how oft would I have gathered thy children together, even as a hen gathereth her chickens under her wings." And the sad part of that verse is, "And ye would not." God had a desire to gather them under his wings, but they would not. I want to speak on the shadow of thy wings for a few moments this evening. Now there are a number of references in the scriptures concerning the shadow of the wings of God. Over there in Psalms 91 is a choice verse to my own heart. In Psalms 91, there in verse number 4, let me read just a few verses. It said, "He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge, my fortress, my God, in him will I trust. Surely he shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler, from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and thy buckler." Here the psalmist makes reference to the fact that God covers his people, those that would trust in him, under his wings. And the truth of God would be our shield and would be our buckler. Turn back just a few pages to Psalm 63. Here's another reference to the wings of the Lord in verse number 7, Psalm 63. I suppose we need to read the a few verses before. Verse 1 says, "O God, thou art my God. Early will I seek thee. My soul thirsteth for thee. My flesh longeth for thee in a dry and thirsty land where no water is. To see thy power, thy glory, as I have seen thee in the sanctuary." I'll tell you, that's a wonderful thing. If you've ever seen it, if you've ever been involved in it, you just can't be satisfied with nothing less than it. "To see thy power and thy glory in the sanctuary, because thy loving kindness is better than life. My lips shall praise thee. Thus will I bless thee while I live. I will lift up my hands in thy name. My soul shall be satisfied with as with marrow, fatness, and my mouth and shall praise thee with joyful lips. When I remember thee upon my bed, meditate upon thee in the night watches. Because thou hast been my help, therefore in the shadow of thy wings will I rejoice." What a truth that is. Because God has been ever present. Because He's been on our mind. Because when we pillow our head at night, He's in our meditation. We rejoice in God. He says, under His wings, under the shadow of His wings, I will rejoice. What a wonderful place to be. Over there in Psalm 61 is another reference to the shadow of His wings. Actually, in Psalm 61 there in verse number 4, He says, I will abide in thy tabernacle forever. I will trust in the covert. That is, under the covering of thy wings. Selah. Just think about that. God spreading His wing over and covering you. Then again, in Psalms 57, there in verse number 1, be merciful unto me, O God. Be merciful unto me, for my soul trusteth in thee. Yea, in the shadow of thy wings shall I make my refuge, till these calamities be overpassed. Oh, can I tell you, there's a lot of calamities in this world. But thank God, in the shadow of His wings, there is a refuge from the calamities of life. Thank God for that. Now, you know, a lot of folks have to just weather the storm. A lot of folks haven't got a refuge to run to. They haven't got a covering. They don't have a Lord that they can take and nestle under next to. But you and I have been given the sheltering protection of the shadow of the wings of God Almighty. What a wonderful place that is to be. May I give you just another reference right here? Over there in Psalm 17, there is the book of Psalms opens up. In Psalm 17, verse number 8, well, there's so many things I'd like to say, but in his prayer, David prays concerning the Lord and what the Lord has done for him and shall do for him. Down there in verse number 8, listen to this. Keep me as the apple of thine eye. Hide me under the shadow of thy wings. Now, isn't it a wonderful blessing that God has you in, not only in His vision, not only in His sight, but He's got His eyes focused upon you, and you are His concern, and you are under the shadow of His wing. Oh, what a wonderful truth that is. The shadow of thy wings. A place of refuge, a place of rest, a place of rejoicing, a place of, here's what I want to say, it's a place where finally you can find some relief. Hallelujah. Now, brother, you know that's what we're looking for, some relief. And somebody says, these calamities, till these calamities be overpassed, thank God there's some relief in the Lord. And I love Him for it. Don't you? Can I have an amen right there? Safety and shelter and security under the shadow of His wings. Now, go back to Psalm 36. In Psalm 36, I'd like to walk down a few of these verses with you, and then I would like to take and show you why, or give to you the reasons why the child of God can have relief under the shadows of the wings of God. Psalms 36 helps us to understand there are some concrete, absolute reasons why you and I do not have to wring our hands off up to our elbows worried about everything. There are some concrete reasons why we can have peace in the midst of calamity and tribulation. There are some reasons we can find comfort and solace under the wings of God. And Psalms 36 helps us to understand that. When he opens up the psalmist starts off with a rehearsal and a picture of the transgressions of men. He begins by displaying to us things that ought to cause a turbulence in our life. And the transgression of the wicked, or a picture of the sinner. Listen to what the psalmist says as he portrays this figure for us. The transgression of the wicked saith within my heart that there is no fear of God before his eyes. He says concerning the wicked, the lost man, the sinner, the man not right with God. He says the first thing that you realize about them is that they're going through life, and if they ever had any regard for God, they don't have it now. There is no fear of God before their eyes. Boy, I tell you, we can certainly testify in the world we live in that is the general idea behind society. No fear of God in their eyes. But then he goes on in verse number 2 and says, for he flattereth himself in his own eyes. That is, he is self-aggrandized. He is flattering himself. And it seems as if he's so caught up in a flattery of himself. It says, until his iniquity be found to be hateful, his crimes are not found out, and he thinks he's got away with them, and until they come to an ultimate conclusion, he's just sailing along, saying, look what I have done. Now, I have deep feelings about different things, and one thing I have a deep feeling about is that when someone has labored and worked and spent and given their life to making a living or making a success in the business world, I am thankful. I love mom and dad shops, don't you? I love success stories and things of that nature. And when I look at the TV and watch all these crowds go busting in windows and ramshacking places, I tell you, I'm like that little old woman that Sister Ann was reading about a while ago coming to church. She pulled out her gun. She's 80 years old. Pulled out her gun. Someone's going to steal out of her store. And she just shot them. She said, I'm fed up with it. I'm fed up with it. They think they're getting away with everything. I'm fed up with it too. I'm telling you, friend, it's a terrible. And there seems to be no justice about that thing. And they just get away with things. Well, they flatter themselves. Then again, he gives us another picture right here in verse number 3. He says, the words of his mouth are iniquity and deceit. That is, his speech is saturated with wickedness and deceit and cursing and defiance of God. Boy, isn't that an indictment upon our generation right now? An ugliness. Now, used to it was old sailors that you compared the ugly speech to. But now, I tell you, some old sailors sound pretty saintly compared to some of these old sisters that I listen to. Isn't that right? And I'm saying it's ugliness in the general aspect of society. What an ugliness it is. Then he goes on just a step farther, and he says not only their speech, but notice, if you will, here in verse number 3, the latter part. He hath left off to be wise and to do good. That is, he has scorned wisdom, respectability, law-abiding citizens and law-abiding life. He's left it off. He's left off to do good. Now, what a sad state of affairs is painted for us here. Then again, in this picture of the wicked, the transgression of the wicked, look at verse number 4. He deviseth mischief upon his bed. Now, when you go to bed, you ought to go to sleep. Isn't that right? And if you work all day, you will. But he goes to bed, and when he should be sleeping, he's thinking about all the evil he can do, all the mischief that he can do. And he loves it. He says he setteth himself in a way that is not good. He abhorreth not evil. Boy, what an awful picture you have of the transgression of the wicked, and in our society, how it's so real. We can see it. Take a blind man not to see it. Am I right? I mean, somebody help me out. You know, I mean, this is the picture right here the psalmist lays out for us. But then, over and against this awful picture of the wicked and the transgressions of those that do not know God, there's a contrast. A contrast against this depravity of the perfection of God. Boy, I'm amazed sometimes just to contemplate on the perfections of our God. Notice in the scriptures here, there in verse number 5, he begins to talk about thy mercy. God's mercy. Now, it's an awful black picture in them first four verses. But then he's reminded of the mercy of God, and he says, oh Lord, it is in the heavens. Now, that idea is not just that it is in the heavens, but the mercy of God extends from the heavens and back beyond the heavens. In fact, the idea in this verse right here, according to Mr. Barnes, is that this idea of God's mercy is very exalted. He says to the very heavens as the highest object of which man can conceive. The idea is not that the mercy of God is manifested in heaven, nor that it has its origin in heaven, though that is true, but that it is the most exalted of the most exalted nature. It is so high as man could ever conceive. Man cannot begin to comprehend the majesty of the mercy of God. It's in the heavens. Thy mercy. And so, in contrast to the wickedness of transgressors, the open sin of sinners, he says the mercies of God are so high, it's beyond our conception. Then he goes on a step farther. Not only thy mercy, but look at thy faithfulness. Thy faithfulness reacheth unto the clouds. And this is simply a way of saying that the faithfulness of God is limitless. It's limitless. It's far from anything that our little finite mind can understand. Everything about God is limitless. It's great. It's vast. It's incomparable. Have you ever thought about the fact that God does not forget? The only thing recorded that God would forget is that he would remember our sins no more. And he purposely does that. He doesn't just randomly forget our sins. He purposes not to remember our sins. God never forgets. He never fails. He never falters. He never forfeits his word. The word of God shall stand forever. And I bless the Lord for it. Every portion of thy word, he is true to every promise he makes. I was able to lean over Brother Mike some time ago and whisper in his ear, Brother Mike, I've read the scriptures. It's true. It's all true. Every promise he said is true. I want to say to you, thank God, he's faithful. He's faithful. And he's true to every promise, every prophecy, every covenant. And likewise, every threat the Bible makes is also true. Every judgment shall come to pass just as truly as every promise. He'll make it good because of his faithfulness. Numbers chapter 23 verse 19 says, God is not a man that he should lie, neither the son of man that he should repent. He hath said, and shall he not make it good? Therefore, as believers, thank God, as believers, you and I can say that his compassions fail not. They're new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness, oh God our Father. Hallelujah. He says, God is a God of mercy, but he's also a God of perfect faithfulness. Verse number 6, he says, thy righteousness. He points out the fact that thy righteousness is like the mountains. We live in a mountainous area. Sister Ann and I were sitting on the porch drinking a cup of coffee, watching the mountains just stand there. You know what mountains speak of in the Bible? Mountains speak of stability and steadfastness. They're immovable. They're dependable. They're majestic. Several places between here and other parts of our fair country around here, you can look over to the left or to the right and you can feel yourself to be just a minute little detail in comparison to the majesty of the mountains. His righteousness is like a great mountain. He can always be depended upon to do right. Shall not the God of all the earth do right? Yes, he shall. You can see it perfectly manifested at Calvary. Whenever the righteous demands of God and of the law demanded payment for sin, sin must be paid for. The penalty must be meted out. And so when Christ became sin for us, the torrents of God's judgment was meted out upon him. And now God, because of that, can be the justifier of those that believe in him. Oh, you talk about wonderful. Righteousness has been satisfied and satisfied on my behalf. God poured his wrath out and judgment out upon Christ in order that the Savior could be my Savior and righteousness could be my portion and that God could be righteous in saving a sinner such as I am. Thy righteousness, only God could do that. Then again, he says, not only thy mercy, thy faithfulness, thy righteousness, but he goes on to say, thy judgments are a great deep. He says of the Lord that his judgments are, they're just so deep, unfathomable. God's decrees, God's plans, God's thoughts, God's decisions. He says that they're so deep we can't comprehend them. In fact, the Apostle Paul had this to say about the depth of the wisdom and of the judgments of God. How wonderfully complex and yet gloriously profound and simple they are. How wise they are. Listen to how the Apostle Paul says it. All the depth of the riches, both of the wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable are his judgments and his ways past finding out. For who hath known the mind of the Lord? Who hath been his counselor? Or who hath first given to him, and it shall not be recompensed to him again? For of him and through him and to him are all things, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. His judgments are great deep. The psalmist in his psalm not only has shown us the transgressions of the wicked, give us a picture of that, but he's magnifying the perfection of God. His thoughts are taught up in the Lord. And look in verse number 6, he says, thy righteousness is like great mountains, thy judgments is a great deep. O Lord, thou preservest man and beast. Here's the providence of God. God's in charge of all things. Here's what we might call temporal salvation for everything. Here's God taking and preserving every creature, providing for every creature, every beast of the field, every fowl of the air, God feeding it. Somebody said God never made a possum he didn't make a persimmon tree for. I believe that, don't you? I don't know why in the world God would preserve rats, but he does. Isn't that right? He let some of them live out at our house. God, he preserves all things. His providence is everywhere. I'll tell you how far it reaches. He counts every hair on your head. Isn't that right? And then there's not a little sparrow that falls to the ground unbeknown to human man that God does not attend its funeral. I'm saying to you, thank God, thank God. All of us have got God's attention. God is perfect. Verse number 7. He makes mention of how excellent is thy loving kindness. The loving kindnesses of God. Verse 10, he also, oh, continue thy loving kindnesses. He makes mention of the loving kindnesses of God. There is nothing in the entire realm of human life more precious than the loving kindness of God. Nothing greater than God's love towards us. Eternal, sovereign, infinite, causeless. You did nothing to cause God to love you. I did nothing to earn or merit the love of God. Unchangeable. He loves me. Isn't that something? I don't have to carry the little flower around like when you was a little child. He loves me not, you know. If I'm good, he loves me a lot. If I'm not so good, he'll... Oh, no, friend. He loves you. That's an amazing thought to me. And I was thinking about how marvelous and how wonderful the love of God is and how inseparable we are from the love of God. I was thinking about what the Apostle Paul said over in Romans chapter number 8. Listen to this. He says, and we know verse number 32. He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It's God that justifieth. Who is he that condemneth? It's Christ that died. Yea, rather is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession. Who shall separate us from the love of God in Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? I won't say there's nothing that can separate us from the love of God. Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors. The apostle said, through him that loved us. I'm persuaded. Now, you know it's good when you really get persuaded about something, ain't it? I mean, you really get certain about it. You're very confident in it when you're fully persuaded about it. Now, some people are persuaded about that like I'm persuaded about some of these commercials on TV. Huh? I try to get the number down real fast and I'll order the whatever it is only to be disappointed. You know, I had a false persuasion. But I'll tell you, I'm not falsely persuaded about the good love of God. I say we got full confidence. I'm persuaded, Paul said, that neither death nor life nor angels nor principalities nor powers nor things present nor things to come nor height nor depth nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ. Hallelujah. The loving kindnesses of God. Now look at it again. There's no tongue that can fully express it. It's so infinite, so of such a magnitude that we just can't comprehend it. And yet we're told to press on and try to comprehend the love of God. Oh, what it passes understanding, but still it's real. The goodness of God is an ocean covering every mountaintop. And this terrestrial ball, thank God, reaches higher than any opposition that we have to face. The love of God. It's the fount from which flows that necessary good for every man, woman, boy, and girl who has an interest in it. The love of God. Amazing and wonderful. Thank God for it. Now look at the verse 7. How excellent is thy loving kindnesses, O God. Therefore, because of your mercy, because of your faithfulness, because of your righteousness, because of your judgments, because of your providence, because of your loving kindness, therefore the children of men put their trust under the shadow of thy wings. Hallelujah. Isn't that something? That's the reason. That's the why we do it. We found a refuge under the wings of the Most High. Because of who He is. Who He is. You can't put your confidence in men. The arm of the flesh will surely fail you. But there's a refuge for us. There's relief. Protection under His wing. Privilege under His wing. Peace under His wing. Relief under His wing. I love verse number 8. Not only is there protection, but provision. They shall be abundantly satisfied with the fatness of thy house. Oh, can I tell you, those that would abide under the wings of God, there's something about getting fed around the house of God. There's something satisfying about it. There's something abundantly satisfying about it. You talk about quality of life. You talk about meaningfulness of life. Oh, those that abide under the wings of God have that in the house of God. I know you can't really imagine this, but I love good cooking. I really do. I love it. I love it. I sit right down and I eat till I haven't got an appetite, you know. And I like, now don't get me wrong, but I like all kinds of stuff, but I really like country cooking. I mean, give me a piece of pot roast or roast beef or something other, you know, a little gravy and a biscuit, some mashed potatoes and some squash and maybe some greens or something other. I mean, just that's what I was raised like that. I love it. Don't come up here no little salad. I mean, y'all can have the salad. I don't mind it. And I like a salad whenever I get started on it. But there's something about it that just don't. It don't charge me like the other does. Now, y'all like it. Some of y'all like it, I know. But I like country cooking. Isn't that right? And my preference, when I come to the house of God, I want to hear a preacher get back and preach. I want to see him sweat a little bit, sling a little snot sometime, spit on the front row. That's my preference now. You know, not everybody's not like that. And I'm not saying that other food ain't good. Y'all get me now? I like it all. You know, I ain't saying it ain't good. I'm just telling you my preference. Isn't that right? I don't know where that come from. That's just kind of on the side. Satisfied, abundantly satisfied with fatness in thine house. Hallelujah. God. F.B. Meyer said, God gives the sparrows cupfuls. He said he gives the saints rivers full. He said, drinking of the pleasures, rivers of pleasure. Can I say it's a joy to come to the house of God? I'm talking about abiding under his wings now. Then go a step farther. Look at verse number 9. Verse number 9 says, for with thee is the fountain of life. Well, Jesus is the fountain of life, you know. He's not only the light of the world, but he's the life. In him is life. life more abundantly. And in thy light shall we see light. You remember when Jesus opened the eyes of that fella? And he said, what do you see? He said, well, I see men as trees. And he touched him again. He said, now what do you see? He said, I see all things clearly. Artists went out there, and out there at Goshen Pass, we come up there one day, and there was a fellow out there and had a canvas, and he was painting, you know, and everything. Boy, I was amazed at that thing. And we talked to him for just a minute. He said he had to get the light just right. There's something about natural light that will allow you to see everything in its natural beauty. And in thy light, you and I are able to see the things of God in their beauty. If you try to see it in an artificial light, you'll see part of it, but you'll never come away with a full appreciation of all there is in it. In his light we see, we have light. Just as natural light reveals the true form of something, so the light of God, it so enriches and enables us to see the things of God. We're able to form the right opinions about things. We're able to see spiritual realities like they ought to be. We're able to see this world for what it is. We're able to see others for what they are. And we're able to see ourselves as we ought to. Verse 10 and 11, the psalmist prays for a continuance of the loving kindnesses of God. And he makes two references here. One to the foot of pride or of arrogance. He said of the wicked, they have a foot of arrogance about them. Foot of pride cometh against me, and let not the hand of the wicked remove me. But I'll tell you, more than the folks out yonder, my own feet fumble and stumble arrogantly in their own way. I need preservation from that. My own hands don't do right and don't portray the Lord as they ought to and hold on to the things of God that they ought to. I need preservation from that. I don't want to be dominated by my proud, arrogant feet, nor to be dominated by my hard, wicked hands in this world. We need a shelter. We need safety. We need security. That comes from being under the shadow of his wings. Here's the way the Irish Spanky said it in his song, Under His Wings. Under his wings I am safely abiding, though the night deepens and tempests are wild. Still I can trust him. I know he will keep me. He has redeemed me. I am his child. Under his wings, who from his love can sever? Under his wings my soul shall abide, safely abide forever. Under his wings, what a refuge in sorrow. How the heart yearningly turns to his rest. Often when earth has no balm for my healing, there I find comfort, there I find rest. Under his wings, oh, what precious enjoyment. There will I hide till life's trials are o'er. Sheltered, protected, no evil can harm me. Resting in Jesus, I'm safe evermore. Under his wings, who from his love can sever? Under his wings, my soul shall abide, safely abide forever. Under his wings, the psalmist lays out the reason that we ought to abide under the wings, in the shadow of the wings of our Lord. Amen. Amen. Let's stand together. In the rock we found a refuge. Under the tree, the shadow of the tree, we found rest. In the shadow of His wings, we find a wonderful relief from the calamities of this life. Help us, O Lord, to find that place under His wings. Let's bow for prayer. Our Father, indeed, we bless Thee tonight for Thy good mercy, Thy loving kindness. We marvel, our Lord, at Thy faithfulness. Our confession tonight is that Thou hast been so good to us. Thou hast loved us with an everlasting love. Thou hast drawn us to Thyself and wooed our heart to where from our heart we can say we love Thee. I pray that You would take and cause us to dwell under the shadow of Thy wings this evening. Bless each person here. There are those with heavy burdens, those that are going through deep waters and dark experiences. Wouldst Thou help them this evening? Keep them, our Lord. Shelter them. Help us not to turn aside and go our own way, but help us to scooch up under close under the shadow of Thy wing. Thank You now for this time together. Thank You for each one that's here. Blessed be Your wonderful and precious name. Amen. Amen. The Lord bless you tonight. Thank God so much for you.